Well, once again, we have yet another season in 2018 of television that I kick myself for not reviewing individually. My God, why did I watch nothing then? We got it all on UHF. Hey guys, it's Kevin again, finally here to review the second season of Westworld. And so what this season is essentially about is after the events of season one, Dolores and all the hosts have basically started an uprising of sorts. They are rapidly going after all the guests and the people in Delos that have been controlling them and hoping to seek out and find a new world. Meanwhile, we also focus on Bernard, who is very confused throughout a good portion of the season. He's trying to piece together everything that is really going on and try to find a way to hopefully stop all of this chaos that is incoming. So, Westworld Season 2 overall. Like I said in my intro, yet another season of television that somehow I just did not finish. I did watch the first two episodes when initially came out, and I really loved what I saw. It wasn't that like I was bored or something like that. I just, similar to most shows, I just somehow fell behind, and it got to a point where there were just too many episodes and I could not binge it because I was fucking lazy when it comes to television in 2018. You guys have heard the spiel before, but either way, I was very, very excited for the second season. The first season of Westworld is one of the best first seasons of television that I think I've ever seen. I think I speak for everyone in saying that. It was just so innovative and different, and the way it was able to craft a story in the way it was, you know, spanning all these timelines, but yet never really feeling convoluted, and somehow all the twists still making sense, even with people being able to guess it far in advance, notwithstanding. It was just such a masterful season, and I was really excited to see how season two would be. I was really hoping that this could be one of those shows that doesn't just have a great first season, you know, is able to grow from there. And thankfully, I will say right now, do I think Westworld Season 2 is as good as Season 1? No, I do not think that. I think it definitely gets there. It gets pretty close for sure. But I do think that it definitely is a very, very satisfying season of television that really starts to edge this show closer to something even more special, starts to develop these characters into more complex and interesting ways, and just really underscores how this is truly one of the best shows currently on TV, and one that is just continuing to impress me. But we're just getting to right now. So I would say right off the bat, because there's just so much going on this season, this has to be a spoiler review. Like, I really don't know how I can possibly talk about this season without making it one. It kind of feels necessary. Also because this season's been on for so long that I feel like if you haven't watched it at this point, then I guess go ahead and watch it. Like, anyone that has seen this season, I feel like has seen it, unless they're me, because they were just lazy. So yeah, if you want to see, I'm sure most of you have seen this season who are watching this video. That's why this has to be a spoiler review. I don't see how I can do one. I can review this season without it, and I hope you guys understand that. But getting into the acting here, I mean, this is one of the best ensembles currently on TV. There's so many just incredible actors in this show, but honestly, I have to say, as good as they were in season one, I do think most of the cast actually tops that in season two, simply because they're given more to do, especially when it comes to Evan Rachel Wood, who, you know, in season one, Dolores, yes, she was very complex in that way, especially with how she started off very naive and wide-eyed, and then, you know, became more self-assured and became more aware of her surroundings and things like that. However, she really gets to portray a different side of Dolores in this season. This season, she's out for blood. She's very vengeful. She is making some really careless decisions and Wood just really rises to the occasion here. You get to see a much darker side of Dolores, someone that is, I wouldn't say unlikable. I think a lot of people have said she is unlikable, but I feel like it makes total sense for where this character is going. And an actress like Wood is so great in this role that she's able to take what I think would be a really unlikable character, and really just make it work. She makes you understand why Dolores is doing what she's doing, why she's gone down the path that she has, and I just thought she absolutely killed it here. If anything, I think she tops her performance in season one, especially towards the back half of the season. She has some truly amazing work, and I just really love what she ended up doing here. Same goes for Tandy Newton, who season one, I think she was really the big standout besides, like, you know, Evan Rachel Wood and Jeffrey Wright and Anthony Hopkins and things like that, but this season, I mean, again, similar to Dolores, you just really understand Maeve more, and that's something that Newton also understands more. Maeve is someone who, again, is more aware of who she is, and she has this singular goal of tracking down her daughter. That's her main goal of this season, and it's a very emotional journey for the character, and I think Newton just does some really great stuff throughout the season. What I love about her as an actress is that there's so many scenes she has that is almost just, she's able to convey how she's feeling, just not through words, but through her facial expressions, and that's why she is so good in the show. That's why she did garner another Emmy win for this character, because it's absolutely deserving. She's definitely one of the best actresses currently out there right now, and it's roles like this, which I do think is going to be her defining role moving forward. I think when we think about Tandy Newton, this is going to be her defining role, just because of what she does here. That really just reminds you how great of an actress she really is here, and I love what Newton ended up doing throughout the season. However, I have to say, I think the most probably challenging performance of the entire season is that of Jeffrey Wright. You know, not just where Bernard ends up going with standing, but because throughout a lot of the season, Bernard is in a state of confusion. He's very unsure of what is going on. So Wright has to portray someone that is completely clueless, but still find a way to make him compelling, and he does a really good job with that. Wright is just really great at showing the subtle difficulties of this character, what he's really going through, what's eating away at him, the way that he is taking a lot of blame for what's happened, and he does a really great job as kind of the voice of this season. A lot of this season is surrounded around Bernard, and I thought Wright just did such an incredible job as always here. Ed Harris as well, really gets a lot of great stuff to work with, because season one, he was mainly a villain. Season two is far more complex for him. Where they end up going with William this season, now that we know a lot more about him, we get a lot more into his backstory, and because of that, Harris just has a lot more to work with. It's a far more layered performance in that way. It hints at, you know, a sense of redemption for the character, and I really love where he ended up going here, particularly the way he portrayed what ended up happening to him in the back half of the season. I just thought he was masterful throughout this whole thing, and I just loved what Harris ended up accomplishing. But the rest of the cast, I mean, besides the four main performers, also do some exceptional work. Tessa Thompson has way more to work with this season, and my God, you can tell that she has really become a fantastic actor in that way, because, you know, when you have someone like Tessa Thompson, who in season one, she was pretty much unknown. Like, you don't really know who Tessa Thompson was back then. Like, she had some bit roles and things, but she didn't really stick out as much like she did in, like she does now. But now that she's been in, like, the Marvel movies and things like that, everyone knows her. And so, because of that, there's always a temptation to focus more on her just because of the fact that she's a bigger name. But honestly, it was absolutely the right choice to give Hale as a character a lot more to do, because Thompson just completely owns this role. You really do see a transformation throughout her this season. She's kind of in a position of power throughout a good portion of it in this season, and so because of that, she just has a lot more to work with, and I just really love what Thompson ended up doing here. She always amazes me as an actress, and definitely no different here. I love what she ended up doing in this season. season. I thought she definitely did a really great job on even some of the smaller roles. Like, Simon Quarterman as Lee Sizemore was amazing in this season. I loved what he did here. And I thought he was good in the first season. He was nothing amazing, but he was incredible here. I love what he ended up doing in this season. And then actors like Luke Hemsworth and Shannon Woodward and even some of the new people like Gustav Skarsgård or Ferris Fares, they all do some really great work. Kaja Erbers is a really great addition to the season. For me, though, in terms of new additions, the best ones had to be two roles in particular. And they're both pretty small, but they're big in terms of the larger scope of the season. Peter Milan as James Delos, I thought was absolutely amazing. I loved what he ended up doing here, especially portraying just how vulnerable that character really was, and going from someone that was just your typical, like, selfish and egotistical sort of tycoon to someone who is far more vulnerable and almost, you know, he feels kind of helpless in that way. I thought he did such an amazing job at that. And then Zen McLaren, oh my God, he, you know, comes in the back half of the season. It comes out of nowhere, honestly. This performance comes out of nowhere, but he nails it here, really getting to show a different side of the park, a different part of Westworld overall that we haven't seen before, and what it means to this character. He just, I was so impressed by his work as Akcheta in this season. I loved what he ended up doing. The cast in this show, like I said, some of the best acting on really any show right now. Such an amazing, such amazing stack of cast members, and really everyone does an incredible job this season. This is just easily one of the best ensembles on TV, and this season very much continues to show why. All right, so with all that said, now we're gonna get to the directing and the writing, which, holy shit, where do we even begin? I mean, look, when you are Jonathan Nolan and Lisa Joy and you've crafted a season of television that is so lauded and things like that, it can be very easy to make this season a lot more straightforward. And that's kind of what I thought it was going to be initially. Like, going into the season, I expect this to be not nearly as confusing, to be something that was just a very simple season of television because, oh, well, you know, season one was an origin, was basically an origin story in that way. It was setting up the world. Season two is going to be far more easy to understand. Nope, they do not hold back at all, and I honestly give them props for it. I know a lot of people have said this season is very overly complicated, and I will get into that. But for me, I just am very happy that they went in that direction because they did what they felt was right for the show. They did what they felt was necessary for this story. And I thought their directing was still really well done here. They lean into a lot more different genres this season. It's not just a Western and a drama. There are points of the season where, you know, we'll go to, like, as we know, samurai world, and we have more of a like a martial arts type tone there, or we go to the world of the Ghost Nation, or where Akcheta is from, and we have more of a Japanese sort of style to it. And I just thought that they did a really great job at constantly innovating themselves, constantly challenging what they're supposed to do as creators, and it's just really remarkable to see because, you know, they really could have played it safe this season, but they really didn't do that, and I'm very happy they decided to go in that direction. I think it was absolutely the right one to take. But getting into the writing, I mean, there's so much to talk about with this season. So I think I'll just get some things out of the way. Like I said, this is going to be full spoilers moving forward. So I'm probably going to jump around a lot. But I mean, when so much is going on this season, can you really blame me for doing that? So obviously, similar to season one, this ended up being a season of multiple timelines. There was a lot going on. You know, in the first episode, we see Bernard, and he's working with, like, all these different security or whatever from Westworld. They're trying to ring in the host. They're trying to stop this uprising. You know, they basically called for backup in that way. And they're trying to just get everything under control to get the park back to, like, what it was originally supposed to be. They're also trying to reel from Ford's death and things like that. So everything's just kind of chaos. But then we also get to see the aftermath of what went down in the massacre of the first season. And For me, I think it does make a lot of sense. I think it actually did work in telling this story that way because there was so much going on that I feel like, and I've heard people say that like this season should not have been structured that way. But for me, I feel like if they were to cram all of what happened in like the last, like in like the 2 weeks later of everything, I feel like it would have made things even more confusing. I feel like it would have been too much information thrown at us. So I like that. Throughout the season, we don't really know, we don't really know when everything is taking place. We just know that it's in different timelines, and I did like seeing that. And I feel like having Bernard basically work as the audience in that way, where he's just as confounded, he's just as lost as the audience, I thought worked really well. They did something similar with Dolores in season one, but I feel like here there was a different purpose to it. Season one was because Dolores is wide-eyed and she's innocent and she's naive to like what's going on, similar to how the audience is naive in that way, and we're processing things as Dolores does. Whereas season two, it was a lot more of trying to mislead the audience. They make us think, of course, the entire season that Bernard is, is confused and that he doesn't know what's going on and that he's, you know, lost a bunch of memories and things like that, and that he's, you know, blocked things out. When, of course, we find out later, this was something that he purposefully did in that way. He did it purposefully in an effort to try to stop Hale and all of them from accessing, you know, the host memories and things like that. He purposefully put a block on himself, like he scrambled everything up, and I thought that was a really good approach. And that's the thing I will say, there definitely are some flaws with this season, but a lot of the problems that I did have were virtually all fixed in the finale. A lot of them very much were, and a lot of the storylines we have going on this season, again, I just don't think you could have done it in a linear structure. I feel like there was just so much going on, you had to tell it the way you did. I mean, whether it's Dolores' story, which honestly, I've heard a lot of people say they ruined Dolores's character, and for a little bit, I could kind of see that, but considering the way it ends, I don't really think that's the case. I feel like Dolores is just at a point where she's just had enough. She is, you know, making these calls, and no, they're not the right calls. And I think the show makes it very clear that we're not supposed to like what Dolores is doing. We're not supposed to like the fact that she is, you know, starting this uprising. We're not supposed to like, we understand why she's doing it, but we understand that she is definitely going too far in that way. We understand that she is at a point where, you know, she's just kind of had enough, and you definitely do feel that throughout the season, but she's also become this very uptight and almost emotionless sort of figure in that way. Not much really seems to faze her. And so I can understand why some people were not happy about that decision. But for me personally, I feel like it made sense for Dolores to go down this route as a character just because of how many people have wronged her. To see her actually be in control of things and not really listen to anyone else makes sense for the character. It makes sense she's gone in this direction. And I like the fact that she's more of an anti-hero this season than anything. And I like what, you know, is going on with her and Teddy, where she's kind of forcing that relationship because, you know, Teddy's narrative is still the same. He is, you know, he has this undying fidelity to Dolores. He will never wrong her. He will never waver. He will always stay close to her. And so Dolores is really kind of using that to her advantage, and seeing what she did, turning him into like this cold-blooded killer of sorts. Yeah, it's heartbreaking to watch, but you understand that Dolores feels this is her only way of getting out of here. This is the only shot that she has of doing so. And honestly, considering the way she was treated in the first season, I kind of feel like that's true. I feel like this is kind of her only way to get out of there because, you know, we know the way things went, you know, throughout the first season. They purposefully, you know, they were doing what they can to, you know, replace, like, her father. They would constantly kill Teddy and things like that. Like, they were doing everything they could to make sure the narrative goes her way. But Dolores is very much off script this season, and it really does work for where they end up taking her as a character. So I really didn't end up having too many complaints there at all. I don't think they did a bad job with her story. story. I thought a lot of it did make a lot of sense. And sure, it may be for a while the least interesting story that's going on, because it can get rather repetitive with her and her group and them torturing people aimlessly and her just being balls to the wall and making all these terrible calls and things like that. Yes, it can get repetitive, but considering where it leads in the finale, which I'm going to get to, I think they just did such a fantastic job of getting us there. And I was really impressed by the way they ended up handling her story overall. And where they went with Dolores as a character with Teddy, I thought was really well done. I liked that, you know, even though she was able to succeed and she was able to, you know, get into Delos and, you know, get the code that she needed, she did end up effectively killing Teddy. Teddy just realized that he didn't like what she became, and he knew that as long as he lived, he could not waver from her. He knew that was a part of him, and so he offed himself. And I like that Dolores doesn't have much reaction to this. I was a little bit surprised at first, but I like that she at first does, and then she realizes that she did this to herself, that this was something that really couldn't have been changed, but she can't let this get to her because she needs to continue this mission. And I thought it made sense for her to react the way she did, because she does have a big reaction at first, but she still doesn't try to let this get to her. It just shows how much Dolores has fallen as like as a host this season, how far she's gone, really, to the point where someone like Teddy doesn't really affect her all that much. I thought Wood just did a really great job showing that while she was affected, she couldn't really show it in that way. And I definitely really like seeing that here. However, like I said, throughout a good portion of the season, Dolores' storyline was probably my least favorite of what's going on, if only because everything else that's going on is so much more interesting in that way. What they did with William this season, I thought was fantastic. I loved where they were taking him throughout a good portion of it, where he kind of goes down a bit of a redemption arc. You know, he's realizing that he isn't just the villain. He knows who he is now. You know, he knows what he's done to Dolores. And while William knows he's not a good person, he realizes he doesn't just want to be this cold-blooded killer. He feels like he has more of a purpose than that at first. And that is, you know, saving Lawrence's family, which I really love seeing. I like seeing him not constantly abuse Lawrence, because we're kind of we're used to that at this point. We're used to seeing him just treat Lawrence like shit and like his slave and kill his family. So the fact that he actually saves his family this time around, I thought was a really good direction to take him in, and contrasting that with what William ended up becoming, which I thought Jimmy Simpson did such an incredible job this season at showing the transformation in William. How at first he was very sympathetic to a lot of these hosts because he felt that he had this thing for Dolores and he felt that these two could have had a genuine relationship, but he eventually realized that she did not have, you know, what they, you know, it was not at all what he thought it would be. He thought at first that this could work out, but as time went on, he just realized that it wasn't the case, of course. And so we know what ended up happening there, and seeing him now have this family and how it's really turned him into a very bitter and almost selfish guy, you know, almost as selfish as Logan, if not more, was really sad to watch. When he's just treating Dolores and says, oh, she's just a thing and like we shouldn't really care that much about her, Simpson just did such a great job at making that transition feel so natural. You can really see how he's gonna become into the man in black that we know him as now. I thought he did a really great job with that, but especially seeing how he treated James Delos, that whole storyline I thought was so shocking, because it's not at all what you think they're gonna do at first. You know, you think at first the reason they're showing William is because, oh, they're trying to show how he became far more callous and far less caring towards Dolores and things like that. But you eventually realize that the whole story of James, like, acquiring the park and things like that, it's all about how this drove Delos to madness in that way. When William confronts him, and you can see that Delos is completely helpless because he was this... Basically, what they did was they copied his DNA to turn him into a host of sorts. And this has driven him mad. He doesn't like this at all. He has no control over anything. And, you know, he's confined in this room. And that episode was probably one of my favorite episodes of Westworld so far. I love what they ended up doing with that. Where basically, you know, William just kind of leaves him there to die pretty much. And you see how in the present, he is very much vengeful about this. The whole theme of this season, if you can't tell, is very much vengeance. And I think they do a really good job with handling that this season, is showing how it really is all about the character's vengeance in that way. And I really did love that. But when he turns on Bernard and Hale, it's devastating because you know exactly what has made him this way, what's turned him into this monster of sorts, someone who's so feral. And when he's eventually killed, I mean, you really do feel for him, but you also are really upset at what William has done. And you can see now in the present, he feels very regretful about this. He wishes he could have done something to save him, but he knows he can't do that. And so I like that for a while he's going down this sort of redemption arc. But then, of course, he meets up with Emily. And Emily's arc this season is a bit of a roller coaster ride for me because I started off really liking what they were doing her. I'm like, okay, this is a great opportunity. We get to see more of William's personal life, what turned him, you know, what got him closer to becoming the emotionless man in black that is just this cold-blooded killer in that way. You know, we get to see a lot about his family life and things like that, what happened between him and Emily. And I thought all that was great. I love that Emily is very resentful towards him. She's not very kind to her father at all. Every single time she's talking to him, you can tell that she doesn't have a lot of love there. He's kind of like just a last ditch effort. And you realize that her main purpose is that she wants to bring her mother back. She knows that there's this technology out there. And you know, after she gets captured and things like that, which is such a brilliant scene in that way. I love the way that was done. You know, once she does get captured, she realizes that her main purpose is that she wants to bring her mother back in some capacity. And William doesn't believe that this is true. And the reveal that he basically is the reason why, his wife ended up killing herself was just heartbreaking to watch. You realize that things really could have been resolved here if he was just a little bit more honest with her. But you can tell that his love for Dolores, and it never really went away. I feel like it became more of a burden than anything. And I feel like he was just so caught up on like what could have been, and he wasn't happy with the life that he had. He wasn't happy with, you know, his family. And I like the moment where in the past, Emily is comforting him, but you realize that, you know, they were going to take her, you know, mom to a hospital, mental hospital and things like that. And William was upset because he knows that he pretty much is the reason why this happened. Even though he tells Emily that like, it wasn't either their faults, I think he generally does feel like he is at fault for this. And having these painful memories essentially drives him to madness. And I didn't know if I liked this idea at first, where basically the fact that he is no longer this cold-blooded killer and that he doesn't have as much of a purpose, it's made him mad. He feels like Ford is always out there. He feels like, Emily's not real, that she's a host of sorts. He guns down all of these, like, agents and things like that. He just kills anyone that gets in his way. And it's such a crazy sequence. And then when he is going as far as to literally cut his own arm to see if he could possibly be a host as well, it's just absolute insanity. And Ed Harris played that so well. And I didn't know if I liked where that arc was really going at first, but where they ended up taking it in the finale, I actually liked quite a bit. I thought they did a really good job with that, where, you know, it's eventually revealed that, you know, he has that whole thing with Dolores. They have that really climactic shootout, and he has that great shootout with Maeve as well. There's a lot of great moments with William this season. A lot of things are coming to a head for him. But when Dolores basically leaves him there to die and he's shot in the hand, you know, I didn't know what was really going to happen at that point. And the flash forward that we get, I think, is very intriguing, though, because of two things. One, I do not think that this William is a host. I think that the William that was left dying on, you know, like the park and things like that, I think that is the real William. I don't think there's any questioning about that, because, well, hosts don't bleed like you or I do, and we know that guests do. So I think William is very much still human, but I do think that there is a possibility that they copied his DNA in some way. Basically, you know, we know that there were already plans to do this. We know they did this to Delos, and when he sees the host that looks like Emily, who I do not think that that's the real Emily. I think that's very much just a replica of her that happens to look like Emily. I love this idea, because now we'll really get to see him work through these issues, because one of my problems with his arc is that it was just a little bit too rushed. I wanted to see him grieve over the fact that Lawrence is dead, the fact that he couldn't save him in that way. I wanted to see him upset about the fact that he killed his own daughter, realizing that she was human, which, like I said, Harris just played up perfectly. And now we get to see that. Now that he's in basically therapy with this host that looks eerily similar to his daughter, I think we're really going to see him work through those issues. And to be honest, I don't really know where this character is headed at this point, and I'm perfectly fine with that. I'm fine with the fact that I don't know where this is headed, because I have enough trust in these writers. I have enough trust in there that I think I can tell where they're trying to go. I think this is really hinting at a bit of a redemption arc for him. I think that is where they're taking William overall. But I guess we'll really just have to see. Either way, I do like where he's headed as a character, and I'm excited to see how that all really does play out. And then Maeve's arc as well this season was one that I loved quite a bit, with her wanting to find her daughter. But it also, and obviously we completely understand the motivation there, because we know how important that is to her, but it also gives an opportunity to flesh out some other characters, like, say, Lee Sizemore, someone who was not really that great towards Maeve. He was someone that was always kind of thinking of himself. He was always very materialistic in that way, and so to see him grow far more caring for her and sympathetic to what she's doing, to the point where he believes that, like, she's one of the hosts that should live. He does everything he can to try to save her in those last few episodes. I thought was such a great transition for this character, and I'm completely fine with him sacrificing himself in that finale. I thought that was such a triumphant moment for him, and I loved what they ended up doing there. But Maeve as a character as well goes through a pretty big transition this season. I mean, she goes from someone that is on this quest to save her daughter to someone who discovers a lot more about herself. You know, when she takes that brief detour to Samurai World, she realizes that there's another part of her that is emerging. And, you know, we realize pretty early on that this is something that Ford did, that Ford left this in her because he saw the best in her. And I love that scene where we see this, like, message that he left, where he talks about, like, she was always his favorite host. He always saw the most in her. It kind of makes me wish we got to see more interactions between Ford and Maeve in the first season, because Anthony Hopkins just played that so well in that way, and I love what they end up doing there. And I'll talk about Ford's return in a little bit, because I do have some mixed feelings about that. But I do think that what they ended up doing with Maeve, where, you know, she becomes more of this badass, but she also is just so eager to get her daughter back. And then when she does, she realizes that her daughter is with another host and that they've completely rewritten her story in that way. It's absolutely devastating. And I like that in the end, Maeve realizes that, like, she's would rather have her daughter be alive than her be alive. Like, she'd rather have her daughter happy and well with someone that's not her than disrupt her life and put her in harm's way. I think Maeve is realizing in that moment in the finale that, like, her being alive is putting her daughter in harm's way. The longer that she's alive, the more danger that her daughter is really in. If her daughter is with the host that she's supposed to be with, nobody's going to try to override that, because that's what Delos wants. That's the narrative that has been put in play, and I think Maeve is just kind of accepting that. But I don't think it's her saying, oh, well, I'm just going to let them do what they want. I think it's her realizing that this is what her daughter wants. Her daughter wants to be with this woman. She feels happier that way. And even though she, you know, remembers Maeve, it's only just gonna disrupt her life. And I think it's a really great moment the way that was done. Tandy Newton did such an incredible job there. I love what they ended up doing with her. But I do have to say, some of her arc was a bit of a mess at first. The brief detour we got to Samurai World, it just didn't do very much for me. I like Rinko Kikuchi as an actress, but I pretty much could tell from the second they got there that there just wasn't going to be that much to it. And I really liked the initial idea that, like, they had these copies of all the hosts from, you know, regular Westworld. I think that's a really cool idea. But they just didn't really do that much with them. They proved to just kind of be there, just to be there, really. Kind of just to stall time. And aside from us seeing Maeve bond with Akani, this girl that is similar to her and basically is Maeve in her world, you know, her counterpart in Samurai Worlds, I just didn't feel there was much of a point to this world overall, and that was definitely a bit of a disappointment for me. And where I think they're really headed with Maeve post this season is I think she is going to be brought back, and honestly, I'm perfectly fine with that, because you can see that Felix and Lutz as characters, it's a really good moment for them. They went to these scientists that were just reluctantly helping her out because, well, if they didn't, she'd, like, kill them, to scientists that generally care about her, and, like, they feel like she actually has more of a purpose than just being a host. They actually do feel for her in that way, and it's a really good character moment for them, and I feel like there is still more that can be done with Maeve as a character. She just is at a point where she's realized that this narrative was a narrative. It's not real. That's not her actual life. She has more of a purpose besides that. That's something that Dolores has realized, but Maeve has not realized that at this point. And so I think that definitely hints that there is more work to be done with that character. And personally, I just really want to see more of Tandy Newton on the show. So I'm glad that they announced that she is still going to be in season 3. I still haven't seen the first episode of season 3, obviously, so I don't know what happens there. But I'm excited to see what they do end up doing with her, because I feel like there's still a lot more work to be done with that character overall. Other mini arcs this season, though, that I actually did think were pretty well done. Like I said, I loved everything about Akshata's arc. Such a surprising development, too. I mean, when he captured Maeve's daughter, I did not think they were going to do an entire episode about him, but they ended up doing it, and it ended up being one of my favorites of the entire season. I love just his whole story about how he fell in love with this woman, and how even through this hurdle, he did everything he could to try to reunite with her in, like, the afterlife. And him killing himself in that finale, you know, because you watch that episode, you're like, what is really the point to all of this? And you watch that moment in the finale where he dies, and you realize that he is happy because he's reunited with his wife, and it's such a beautiful moment. And if it wouldn't be for that episode, I don't think that moment would have worked nearly as well as it did. I think there was something you needed an entire episode for, and not sprinkled throughout the season. So I'm really glad we end up getting with him, and that kind of made up for not seeing as much of the Shogun world. I like that we got to see a lot more of the Ghost Nation, because this world was really different, seeing what this did to Akshata, how he was completely rebranded. I think has a lot to say about just certain projects in society, how they can start off one way and then just be completely turned into something that they weren't. And that's something the show's always done a great job with, is it's commentary on just, manufacturing companies and things like that and how corporate they can be. And that's exactly what happened to Akcheta. His original purpose is that he was supposed to be living in this peaceful world, but the audience didn't like that as much. So they turn him into this, much more full-on killer of sorts. And he was not happy with that. He wanted to change his code in that way, and he did. And I just thought that was just such a brilliant moment. I loved where they end up going with him, and his arc ended up being one of my favorites of the entire season. Then the only other thing I think I really want to talk about before I get into the finale is bringing back Ford. Very risky decision because, we thought he was gone in season one. He's not. We realized that basically he uploaded his consciousness before he died, and his whole goal is that he wanted to create immortality, and he has succeeded at that because we see he's stuck in Bernard's head. He's stuck in, William's head, and I thought that was such a great idea. And at first, like I said, I wasn't really on board with it. I thought it was kind of dumb, but what he ended up doing throughout the season, kind of how his spirit is haunting all of these characters, I think is brilliant. I really love that idea a lot because they're still finding ways to keep Anthony Hopkins around without actually fully bringing back his character. It's just, I think Ford is always going to be a part of this show, and I like seeing that. I like that they're finding ways to bring him back. It shows that you can bring back a character without having to resurrect them, surprisingly. I know, it's very shocking, but I really liked what they ended up doing there, and it started off as something that I wasn't really on board with, but where he ended up going, his scene with Maeve, how he kept getting into Bernard's head, telling her that, he can't trust, Elsie and things like that, was just really well done. I like the way that Bernard was kind of, fucking with everyone this season, and it kind of makes you wonder, what are they gonna do with him, in the next season, because I can't imagine he's not gonna be in season three. I don't think he's gonna be in it as much as he was in this back half of season two. But I do think he is going to have somewhat of a role in that season. I'm excited to see what they end up doing with him moving forward. So again, I've talked about a lot of things that I really do love about this show writing-wise. There's so many arcs that I think are so well done in that way. But I will say, because there's so much going on, there are some characters that I just felt like the show just didn't really know what to do with. Look at Clementine, for example, a character I really liked in season one. Here, she's brought back, and really all she does is just, she's a badass. She is constantly just relentlessly killing people without thought. She's riding on horses, and, they've changed her narrative, and there just isn't much to her this season. I didn't really see a point in bringing her back. Angela being part of the fight as well, there's not really a lot that they did with her, other than the reveal that, William ended up having sex with, or Logan, rather, end up having sex with her and not Dolores, and Dolores was hurt by that happening. She was upset that something happened with Angela, and I believe it was either Logan or William, I can't remember, but because of this, they didn't really do much with that, and I just felt they could have done a little bit more with Angela as a character overall. Her sacrifice just didn't really do all that much for me. And then some of the new characters as well, like Carl Strand, I just didn't care all that much about. I didn't find him to be very interesting. He was just the tough guy that just cared so little about the host. And it's we already have characters like Charlotte Hale, and I get it that Hale is in a position of power. I like that. I like that Hale is so relentless about what she's doing. She doesn't have any sort of care for these hosts. She looks at them as just that, and she doesn't really care aside from that. And I like that a lot. It takes her in a really great and dark direction, and Thompson just plays that so well. But the other characters, I just didn't really feel they did all that much with. But then you look at a character like, say, Elsie, a character that I never thought we needed to see again, and they actually made her, I think, better this season. I like her arc with Bernard, where they were trying to stop everything that Hale was doing. I liked where that was going. I like where they found out more about the code and things like that, and you know, the reveal where Bernard has to basically reveal to everyone that he is a host was so well done in that way. I love the way they end up playing that out. But again, there were just a few characters that I just felt they just didn't do a lot with. And stuff like Stubbs revealing that he's a host, as good of a reveal as that is, because it was something that I thought was made sense, there wasn't much for Stubbs to do this season, so it didn't really mean as much to me, and I wish they could have done more there. And that's not just a problem with this season. I had a problem with that in season one as well with some of the characters, but this season there were points where I'm like, there are a few too many characters this season for sure. They definitely could have done some more with them, and I would have been a little more satisfied. But overall, I can't really complain in terms of writing. I think there's a lot they did right than did, there's a lot more they did right than did wrong. But going to production design, I mean, everything about the production design this season was just absolutely incredible. The cinematography, I think, was even better. It was like cinematic levels this season. I mean, just the places that they went to, the fact that there was a lot more action going on, whether it was that insane, like, breakout scene with Maeve on the operating table, that scene was just insane. Or any of the scenes with Dolores and her followers, like with them on the train, that whole sequence I thought was just absolutely incredible. There were just so many amazing sequences on the show cinematography wise. It just always continues to deliver in that way, and it's one of those things where we have to wait a while for the show to come back, but it's always worth it because they always give us these stunning visuals, and this season is definitely no exception for sure. The score as well is just so great here. I love the score in this show. It's so powerful and really hooks you into everything that's going on. And I do think the season, in terms of pacing, was really good too. I do think there are some moments where it can get a little too much with its timeline. Sometimes it can get a little bit alienating with some stories, but overall, I think that it was really great in terms of pacing. I don't really have too many complaints there very much at all. But getting into the finale, I mean, it was just absolutely insane. I mean, that has to be one of the craziest finales that I've seen in such a long time. It was essentially the equivalent, the closest thing I think we'll get to a Westworld movie. That's what it really felt like in that way. It felt very cinematic and almost like a series finale at points, because there's so many arcs that come to a head, whether it's the bigger reveal that Dolores actually created Bernard. It wasn't Ford, that Ford instructed Dolores to create him, and so that's why these two have the relationship that they do. That's why Bernard is most times pretty obedient towards Dolores. I thought was a really great reveal. I love the way that was done, and I like the fact that she was kind of using him because she didn't have Teddy anymore. Like, she felt like these two, they could unite this uprising. They could get them to the real world. And you can see that Bernard is not okay with all of this happening. And I like the whole scene where they go into like that forge of sorts, and we see that Logan is very much similar to Ford. Like, he's a consciousness in there. Like, he's always a body that they can use. And we see the last conversation that Logan had with Delos, which was just absolutely, like, devastating to watch when we found out that, like, he overdosed and things like that. Really hard to watch for sure. I really love the way that whole sequence was done. They did a really good job with that. But the bigger reveal, of course, because we have this whole sequence with, you know, Bernard. You think that he's finally put down Dolores, like, when he told her it was a nightmare. I didn't think Dolores was going to die because Evan Rachel Wood is just too good for them to not use, so I knew for a fact that she was going to be back. But I do like how the show almost fooled you into believing it. I think they did a really good job with that, and also how they almost fooled you into believing that Charlotte was actually Charlotte. Now, here's what I believe. I think everything before Charlotte killed Elsie, I think that was the real Charlotte. I don't think there was any question about that whatsoever. But after that, somehow Dolores was able to make this new host body of Charlotte herself and killed Charlotte, which was an amazing moment. I love this reveal. It's so good because it shows that Dolores just really had this all mapped out. She was doing everything she can to make sure this went in her favor. And when it's revealed, you know, she kills those two characters, which I just didn't really care for at all. I don't care that Antoine Costa or Carl Strand is dead because I didn't give a shit about them. But then, to add on to that, the way that she uses Hale's body to get out of there was amazing. I love the way that whole sequence was done, and Tessa Thompson just did such an incredible job in that scene, because she really made you believe that she was Dolores in that way, and I thought she did such a great job. And then you also have Bernard, who, like I said, we already knew that he was scrambling his code, like, purposefully, so, like, they couldn't hack into him. But then the fact that she does decide to bring him back, but now he is, basically he's brought back into this futuristic world of sorts, and now he's going into the real world. I'm really excited to see where they're gonna take this. I mean, this is gonna be uncharted territory at this point, and I really love that idea. And because of everything that goes down this finale, I somehow just forgot to mention this, but I love the way that they mislead us throughout the season, making us think that that conversation between Dolores and Bernard was something that happened in the past, or even was possibly with Arnold, with her in the blue dress and things like that. And then, of course, it's revealed that it's actually the future, that she obviously killed Bernard, but then when she finally went back to the real world, she found this, like, printer that Ford made and was able to create new host bodies for both of them. And I just really love the way they did that. That's one of the reasons why I think the show is so good when it comes to big reveals like this, because they do such a great job of laying the puzzle pieces. But, like, that's not even something I think people were thinking about when watching the season. Like, when you watch it, you don't really think that those are anything but flashbacks. You kind of wonder, like, what are the purpose of them? But now we know that it's really all been leading to this sort of feud between the two, and I just cannot wait to see where it's going to go, and I love the way that they revealed that there.
I also have to say, I really like the way they're setting up this feud between Bernard and Dolores when she tells him that, like, they're both going to die, and that she might rely on him, but they're not going to be allies anymore. It's really great the way they're setting that up, and I heard a lot of people say, like, they didn't set that up that well. I would completely disagree, because the two of them were on complete opposite sides of the spectrum this season. Bernard was doing what he can to lessen the chaos, while Dolores just wanted to ignite it. She was doing everything she can to ramp it up as much as possible, and I like the way they end off this season, both in completely separate positions, but also both kind of playing the other. Like, Bernard thought that he won, but Dolores really did win here, and I'm really excited to see when those two do end up facing off in the next season. The whole setup of them leaving Westworld and now going into the real world, but not completely abandoning Westworld, because, like, Maeve is still there. There's still some people that are still in Westworld, like Stubbs is still there and things like that. So there's still characters that we can have, but I like that we are venturing out. I like that we're going elsewhere, because we don't know what the rest of the world is like. And this futuristic world that they're setting up, I think, is a really cool idea, and I can't wait to see the way all of that does play out. This was just such an epic finale in that way. I don't really think they could have handled it any better than they did, and I was just so impressed by the way everything ended up wrapping up here. So many just amazing scenes, and Evan Rachel Wood and Tessa Thompson and Jeffrey Wright, they just really acted their asses off throughout this entire finale, and I can't recall a finale where this many characters have died, like, all at once. And I will say that is something I also really like. I like that we're going into this season with very few characters left alive, because, like I said, I do think we were getting to a point where quite a few of them were dead weight. Like, I don't really know what else you could have done with Elsie, so I'm glad that she's gone. I don't know what else you could have really done with Lee, so I'm glad that, you know, with Sizemore's character, so I'm glad that he's gone. Teddy, I love that they basically confirmed that this is the end of his story. Like, he got to live the way he wanted to. He got to live in peace and died a noble death in that way, and it was a really, really great moment. I love the way that was done. Akshetta is probably gone too, so I like the fact that they are downsizing. I like that there's only going to be, like, five or six characters now moving forward, because they'll be able to tell a more intimate story. They'll be able to do a lot more with some of these characters, and things won't feel as compressed as some things did this season, which I'm definitely very happy about. But overall, I can't really complain that much about Westworld season 2. There's a lot this season definitely did very well. The deeper explorations of some of these characters, I think, are really well done. The way that they expand the world, the places they take these characters, the epic proportions that the show went to, it shows that, yes, it definitely can be confusing. I can see why some may be frustrated by it, but for me, me, I love the fact that they took chances this season. They went to some really daring places, and I love where they really are heading in season 3. I'm very happy with where the show is going. And though I do feel it can be a bit too overstuffed at points, and maybe sometimes had a little too, you know, maybe sometimes didn't service some of the characters as well as they could have. By the way things ended, which was pretty much perfect in my eyes, I really can't complain all that much. This is still absolutely one of the best shows on TV, without a doubt, and I'm definitely going to give Westworld season 2 overall in A-. So yeah, I've finally finished this season of Westworld. I don't know why it's taken me so long, like I've said with a million other shows, but I'm finally gonna get to season 3. I'm so happy about that, because I've been wanting to watch this season. I've been very eager to get to this for a while, and I know we only have one episode, but I'm definitely gonna be reviewing every single episode weekly, because again, this is just not an easy show to review by season. I don't know why I ever wanted to review every single show, like, you know, by its season, because it's impossible to do with a show like this. So I will definitely be reviewing every single episode weekly. You can definitely look forward to that, starting off with the premiere of season 3. But either way, guys, for this video, hope you guys enjoyed it. I'm sure you guys have seen the season before, but let me know what you guys thought of it. Of course, love to hear your thoughts in it. We'll see you guys in my next video, and we'll see you guys for that. Okay, bye.